During the Second World War, the aviation industry underwent a dramatic transformation. Aircraft manufacturers weren't just building machines, they were forging the future of warfare. The skies became a proving ground for innovation, where speed, altitude, and firepower determined victory or defeat. By the war's end, nations had seen firsthand the power of air superiority, and they were determined to push it even further. As the Cold War began to take hold in the early 1950s, the geopolitical landscape shifted into a high-stakes arms race between two global superpowers, the United States and the Soviet Union. It wasn't just a clash of ideologies. It was a battle for technological dominance in the air, on land, and at sea. In America, aerospace giants like Lockheed, North American Aviation, Convair, and Boeing were pioneering the next generation of military aircraft. Meanwhile, the Soviet Union countered with its own aviation powerhouse, OKB Mikoyan, the design bureau behind the feared MiG series of jet fighters. But amidst this fierce competition, another company was quietly working on something that would soon eclipse them all. Based in St. Louis, Missouri, McDonnell Aircraft, later to become McDonnell Douglas, was preparing to unleash a game-changing aircraft that would redefine modern air combat. This is the story of the F-4 Phantom II, a twin-engine, all-weather, supersonic powerhouse that redefined American air superiority during the Vietnam War and throughout the Cold War. It was the first aircraft in U.S. history to serve simultaneously with the Navy, Air Force, and Marine Corps, proving its unmatched versatility and combat performance. From dogfights over Vietnam to high-stakes standoffs during the Cold War, the Phantom left its mark on nearly every major aerial battlefield of its era. But what gave birth to this aviation legend? What set it apart from everything that came before? And how did it become the most feared and revered warplane of its generation? To understand the legend of the F-4 Phantom II, we must go back to the early 1950s, an era of jet-powered innovation, Cold War paranoia, and an arms race that was unfolding not just on land, but in the skies. At the center of this transformation was McDonnell Aircraft Corporation, later known as McDonnell Douglas, a rising force in American aviation. Though it had proven itself during World War II, the company was no longer content with simply contributing to history. It wanted to shape the future. The engineers and visionaries at McDonnell weren't just chasing speed or firepower, they were chasing dominance. They aimed to create an aircraft that could outfly, outfight, and outlast anything in the skies. A machine that would redefine the very nature of aerial combat. By 1953, the U.S. Navy was facing a new reality. Jet technology was advancing rapidly. The Cold War was escalating, and air combat was no longer confined to close-range dogfights. What the Navy needed wasn't just another nimble fighter. It needed a new breed of aircraft. A next-generation multi-role warplane that could dominate the skies in every scenario. It had to intercept Soviet bombers screaming in at high altitude and Mach speeds. It had to strike enemy positions deep inland with surgical precision. It had to launch from the tight decks of aircraft carriers, endure the stress of supersonic flight, and adapt quickly to rapidly evolving threats. The age of specialized planes was fading. The Navy needed one aircraft that could do it all, and the race to build it had begun. In 1953, the U.S. Navy issued a requirement for a new carrier-based fighter that could serve multiple roles. Not just dogfighting, but long-range interception, strike capability, and high-speed performance. At this time, James S. McDonnell, founder and CEO of McDonnell Aircraft, pushed his team to respond aggressively. He assigned Herman Daniel Barkey, an electrical engineer and experienced project manager, to lead the design effort. Barkey had previously worked on the Demon program and understood the Navy's changing needs. The initial concept was the F-3HH, an evolution of the F-3H Demon, internally nicknamed the Super Demon, it was designed to accept a range of modular weapon systems and sensors. Though it began as a Demon variant, the Super Demon became so heavily revised that it would eventually evolve into an entirely new airframe. At this stage, three key figures drove development. Herman Daniel Barkey, lead program manager, directed the design transition from Super Demon to what became the Phantom II. Robert C. Little, chief designer, responsible for the structural design, layout, and systems integration of the aircraft. David S. Lewis, chief of aerodynamics, oversaw aerodynamic design, especially supersonic performance and wind tunnel testing. Together, they advanced a design that far exceeded the Navy's original expectations. The initial concept called for a single-seat fighter, but by 1955, amid rising Cold War tensions and the emergence of Soviet threats like the Tupolev Tu-95 and MiG-21, the Navy revised its requirements. What they now needed was a twin-seat, twin-engine, all-weather fleet interceptor, an aircraft capable of launching from carriers, reaching high altitudes at blistering speeds, and neutralizing nuclear-capable bombers before they could strike. James McDonnell, recognizing both the strategic urgency and the opportunity at hand, gave Barkey's team full creative control and top priority resources. For him, this wasn't just about building a jet, it was about securing the future of McDonnell aircraft and defining the next generation of American air power. On May 27, 1958, McDonnell Aircraft Corporation unveiled its first prototype of the XF-4H1, a bold leap into the future of aerial warfare. Sleek, powerful, and unmistakably aggressive in silhouette, the aircraft was driven by two General Electric J79 turbojet engines, each delivering over 17,000 pounds of thrust with afterburners, enough to push it beyond Mach 2. It carried 11 weapons hardpoints, capable of mounting a deadly mix of air-to-air missiles, bombs, and external fuel tanks. For carrier operations, it featured blown flaps to improve control during low-speed takeoffs and landings. In its nose sat the state-of-the-art ANAPQ-50 radar, giving it all-weather beyond visual range interception capability. This wasn't just a jet, it was a next-generation war machine, engineered to dominate Cold War skies. Even the airframe was a triumph of engineering. Wind tunnel tests revealed aerodynamic instability at high speeds, leading engineers to angle the outer wing panels upward, creating the Phantom's now iconic dihedral kink to improve stability without compromising agility. The horizontal tailplanes were canted downward to avoid turbulent jet wash, enhancing control during high-performance maneuvers. And the engine intakes? They were lined with over 12,500 precision-drilled bleed holes to manage shockwaves and regulate airflow at supersonic speeds. Every surface, angle, and contour was fine-tuned for uncompromising performance. By July 3, 1959, the XF-4H1 was officially named the Phantom II. Then in December 1960, after extensive testing, the U.S. Navy formally selected it as its frontline fleet defense fighter. The Marine Corps quickly followed suit, and soon after, the U.S. Air Force adopted it as well. A rare case of all three branches using the same fighter. Full-scale production ramped up, and the aircraft was officially redesignated the F-4 Phantom II, marking the start of one of the most iconic combat aircraft in history. The F-4 Phantom II became the first aircraft in U.S. history to serve simultaneously with the Navy, Air Force, and Marine Corps. It set 15 world records for speed, altitude, and time to climb, establishing itself as a dominant force in the skies. Unlike the agile, gun-centric fighters of World War II and Korea, the Phantom was engineered for the missile age, equipped with Sparrow and Sidewinder air-to-air missiles that gave it long-range engagement capabilities far beyond its predecessors. By the time the Vietnam War erupted, the F-4 Phantom was everywhere, conducting bombing runs, escorting strike packages, intercepting MiGs and dogfighting over the jungles and cities of Southeast Asia. It had the speed to chase down enemies at Mach 2 and the durability to absorb heavy damage and still make it home. Still, combat revealed a critical flaw. Early Phantoms lacked an internal gun, designed under the assumption that missiles had made close-range dogfights obsolete. But in Vietnam, U.S. pilots often found themselves in tight-turning battles against nimble MiG-17s and MiG-21s, where heat-seeking or radar-guided missiles frequently fell short. To address this, later variants like the F-4E were equipped with an internal M61 Vulcan cannon, a powerful six-barrel Gatling gun that finally gave the Phantom the close combat edge it had been missing. Throughout the Cold War, the F-4 Phantom proved its worth across nearly every mission profile, serving as a nuclear strike platform, wild weasel, photo reconnaissance jet, and even performing with the Blue Angels and Thunderbirds. Versatile, rugged, and remarkably dependable, it became a cornerstone of U.S. and Allied air power. Its twin engines gave it raw thrust, while its adaptability allowed for constant upgrades in avionics, radar, and weapon systems. As aviation advanced, the Phantom was eventually replaced by next-generation fighters like the F-14 Tomcat, F-15 Eagle, and F-A-18 Hornet. But no aircraft before it had left such a global legacy. From the jungles of Southeast Asia to the deserts of the Middle East, the Phantom flew under the flags of more than a dozen nations, including Japan, Germany, the United Kingdom, Australia, South Korea, Israel, Iran, Greece, Turkey, and Spain, each tailoring it to fit their missions, doctrines, and regional threats. Some air forces operated it well into the 21st century, a testament to the jet's timeless design and battlefield resilience. The F-4 Phantom II was more than just a machine. It was the embodiment of American air power, Cold War resolve, and the technological leap from gun-dueling dogfighters to high-speed multi-role jets. Born in an era of global tension, it became a frontline warrior, a deterrent, and a symbol flown proudly by allies and feared by foes. Its thunderous roar echoed across continents. Its unmistakable silhouette etched itself into the memory of generations, and its legacy soared far beyond the wars it fought. From the decks of aircraft carriers to the skies above Vietnam and beyond, the Phantom carved its place in aviation history, flown by the brave, respected by the skilled, and remembered by all who saw it tear across the sky. If this story of the F-4 Phantom II inspired you, imagine what else history has hidden in its hangars. So hit subscribe for more engineering legends and forgotten war machines. Smash that like button if you learned something new, and check out the full playlist for more stories that shape the skies. Help the channel grow, and let's keep these incredible tales alive, one video at a time.